And I saw my first person murdered when I was 4 years old.
The chief of police
put a bullet down a man's shirt for every button he had.
In the deep, dark hills of eastern Kentucky, that's the place where I trace my bloodline. And it's there I read on a hillside gravestone, "You will never leave Harlan alive." Well, my granddad's dad walked down Cataract Mountain, and he asked Tilly Hilton to be his bride. He said, "Won't you walk with me out of the mouth of this holler? We'll never leave Harlan alive." Where the
Well, when I took Dr. Carmichael's class, I don't know whether to believe him or not, because some of his stories are outrageous.
I think the most off-the-wall story was probably his standardized testing and stuff, how he'd say it was going to like overtake the world, and if you couldn't do a standardized test that well, that you were just going to be a failure at life.
Different kinds of snakes, I remember that mainly.
The aunt, the woman in Justified that owns the store that is the mass murderer and big moonshine developer, apparently his aunt is that lady that was the biggest distributor of moonshine in the South for, I don't know, countless amount of years, I don't know.
He was a big pool shark back in the day.
How he got kidnapped.
You can't lie about getting kidnapped. Like, who does that?
Hey, I got kidnapped and thrown into a van.
Kidnapped.
Kidnapped. Kidnapped and locked in a trunk and almost left for dead.
I didn't know that there was a couple who'd been going around the country for almost 2 months on a killing spree. I was totally oblivious to that. And if I had been paying attention, particularly in the last 2 weeks before this happened, I would have known that nearby in a neighboring state, there were people on a killing spree. And if I'd been paying attention in the 2 or 3 days before this happened, I would have known that they were believed to have been in and around central Kentucky. So I go walking across the parking lot at approximately 11 o'clock on Monday, July 20, with these two people lurking, thinking they're looking at a rich horse gambler and also looking for a car that's not hot because they'd stolen Mrs. Walters' station wagon after they murdered her, but the police had all the information on that and they needed to ditch that, get a car that wasn't known. Stupid me didn't know I was driving a car thief's dream at the time, the fastest thing on the road. I'd never had it above 55 on the interstate highway, but it was a 78 Monte Carlo and it was winning everything in the stock car races. And so that was why they picked me, really, was the car. And I looked like I might have a little cash to get them back where they wanted to be, which was in Dayton and certainly not in Lexington. And I didn't know where we were going. I thought I was dead because I'd seen their faces. I didn't know their faces had been plastered over every big newspaper in the Midwest for a couple of months. The only thing they wanted to do was to get back to Dayton, get to other vehicles they had stashed there, leave me to burn in the July sun. They were through with me once they put me in the trunk, but I had no way of knowing that. It turned out they left me next to an abandoned motel, which was now being used as a house of prostitution, and the bouncer was out for his morning walk, and he heard me banging to get the trunk open. So he called the police, and about a half an hour later, I looked around me, and as they got me out of the trunk, and there must have been 200 to 250 reporters. And I said, "Where am I?" And then I looked at her badge, and it said City of Dayton, and that was Montgomery County, Ohio.
He was studying in Lexington, Next thing he knows, he's in a trunk and somewhere in Ohio. I thought that was pretty crazy.
You know, the one about the kidnapping story, that was hard to believe at first, but then a bunch of my classmates and me, we all got together and we all looked it up on the internet and come to find out it really is true. And it was just like, wow, really, that really happened to him.
Yeah, I mean, some of the stories seem far-fetched, but I guess he knows what he's talking about. I guess he wasn't totally off the wall by this story.
Where the sun comes up about 10 in the morning, then the sun goes down about 3 in the day, and you fill your cup with whatever bitter brew you're drinking, and you spend your life just thinking of how to get away.
After that, the FBI asked me if I would stay in the Dayton area and ride around with the local police or with them in cars, because I had seen him more recently than they had. He was 29 years old at that time. He could have passed for a freshman in college. Slight build, very mannerly, even when he's threatening to kill you. So I stood up there with him for several days, and by that time the FBI had put in a plan of action. It is our information that he has a $300-plus cocaine habit. What we are asking you, the local authorities, to do is to help us after we bring in 150 extra agents in here, which we can do because we've put him number one on the list nationwide, is shut down for as long as you can, up to 72 hours, every drug dealer in the greater Dayton area. His habit won't allow him to wait out the 72 hours or whatever. We know where he's bought before. We'll be waiting on him in those places, and maybe this way we can get him, because if we don't get him off the streets, he's going to kill again, and it's most likely he's going to kill black children, because that's what he likes to do, and he likes to leave a calling card for when he does it. Write nasty, racist little things on walls and windows with their blood. Well, they got him off the street in 72 hours. They using that technique and that plan, they arrested him a couple of days later, but not before allegedly, he never has stood trial for this one to my knowledge, killed a 77-year-old African-American man at a car wash outside Indianapolis, Indiana. He never was, to my knowledge, tried for that. And I was brought in as a sentencing phase witness in 7 of these murder trials where he did get the death penalty.
Because he does like tell you off the wall things that aren't really believable, but I think he actually does know a lot, and he's actually an interesting guy if you get to know him.
Yeah, if they saw any of this, they would, you know, probably respect him a whole lot more, or that he deserves even.
Yeah, I believe if people seen the evidence, they would definitely respect him more in class, because I have a hard time believing it until I just seen the facts myself, so.
They don't really take him seriously, but honestly, this guy's been through probably everything he can possibly go through as, like, being one man. So, like, and I guarantee you, I've only learned half his stories and not all of them either.